Hi, I'm Stephanie Londono, and I teach in the Religious Studies Department. Religion in soccer, or football, as it is known outside of the United States. What is the relationship between the two? And, or are they related at all? If you're a football fan, perhaps understanding religion will help you access your passion in a deeper way, or help you watch the World Cup with different eyes. And vice versa. If you're a religious person, perhaps watching the World Cup can help you understand the different manifestations of your faith in the everyday life. I like to quote this Uruguayan author who also became famous for his writings about football, Eduardo Galeano. And he once said that when it comes to football, there are no atheists. And perhaps we're beginning to see that phenomenon here in the United States. Maybe not quite yet. However, when we think about these two very charged words, religion and football, in our Western imaginary, we tend to have a very superficial understanding between the two. Indeed, we may have the very sort of trite comparisons between the players and Greco-Roman gods, the fields or stadiums as churches or as cathedrals, the FIFA as the very Vatican, or coaches as charismatic pastors or priests and rabbis. But there's so much more to that, that perhaps goes beyond this sort of popular language. But in reality, when we're speaking about these two words, these two concepts, religion and sports, we have these two sort of images come up, and they don't correlate to each other most of the time. Because when we think about religion, it is often thought about in a very private context, as this thing that we do in a private space, in a specific time, in a specific place, with sort of a group that we get together with to work on our spiritual internal aspects. Very vertical, transcendental aspect, right? When we think about football, the images that are evoked are very mundane. If anything, they're very opposite. They're exciting, they're exuberant. We have this extreme colorful, if anything, is aggressive and very mundane, sort of praising for a miraculous goal to go in and give us this pleasure of victory and so on. So you see, when we think about religion, we categorize it as a vertical experience, whereas when we think about football, we tend to do it in a very horizontal, everyday, mundane way. But again, this is a very limited approach. And for this, I like to remember Rudolf Otto, who in his classic, The Idea of the Holy, spoke about religion beyond its moralistic or structured and ritualistic aspect. He talked about the mysterious fastiness in tremendum. And indeed, we can find these aspects very much present in football. We can see it manifest in the very feeling that we have, the ontological transformation of change that we have when we enter a stadium. It's very similar, for example, have you ever entered a church when it's empty? It feels very particular, perhaps similar to the feeling that you get when you enter into a stadium when it's actually empty. It is an ontological change. Entering into this sacred space, something different. We also have this fascination, this attraction, this awe that is majestic, larger than life when we're watching football, beautiful passes, when we find the keeper actually getting that impossible ball and so on. Or the tremendum, perhaps many of us saw it during the penalties in many cases, when we're reduced to a very creaturely feeling of fear, just sort of breaking apart in tears sometimes. So this mysterious fastness tremendum is in constant play throughout the entire game or during the entire experience of football in general. But it goes even beyond that. When we talk about religion and sports, indeed, we have to be very meticulous about how we study or observe the players themselves, how they enter into the field in such a ritualistic manner. How they behave and how do they actually celebrate among their peers when they score, and how do they exit the field victoriously or perhaps mourning their loss. And so I like to give you four main corners of this relationship. We can definitely go on and on, because this relationship between religion and football is nothing new indeed. But to begin with, we have to remember that religion and football are both Catholic. And by that I mean with lower C Catholic, universal. There is an experience that is lived across the world. And because it is universal, that means that it can be absolutely interpreted in different ways, maintaining, of course, a certain structure, certain rules. But different coaches, different players, different cultures manifest their football in different manners. And this is one of the many beauties that we get to witness during the World Cup. And so in this universality, we actually tend to understand our difference in each other in an extremely structured way, even amid the chaos that we tend to sort of approach the World Cup and football in general. So the first comparison, the first connection would be that of the communal aspect. Religion is about making communities, reminding us that we are communal beings, bonding us together despite of and because of our diversity. And this is extremely important because even if we are political dissidents, we do not get along with each other, this is the moment when we come together. We understand our identity as one, and we can actually see this manifest on the field. Even if we have many different talented players, if they do not come together as a team, the whole game falls apart. So this communal aspect is extremely important to understand. And another example of that would be the red card, would be to get expelled from the field, synonymous from expulsion from your tribe, excommunication, that means your own death. Because we are, as beings that are, of course, very egocentric, we must be reminded over and over again that we belong to a wider community, to the same colors and so on. Another important aspect here would be the cathartic aspect. When it comes to football, we experience this almost violent, aggressive feeling that René Girard speaks about in his book, The Violence and the Sacred. He speaks about the structure of the sacred. We tend to take for granted how religion is not just about passivity, but also helping us understand, cope, and somehow translate this inherent violence that we have as humans, put it inside a sacred space that is absolutely structured, and somehow purify us from this violence and transform it into something that can be a bonding experience. So those tribalistic behaviors that we find in cheering for our own team and shouting sort of names and this us versus them, that is a very peculiar characteristic of religion. And this is the reason why when we understand and if we speak about sacrifice, nowadays understood in different manners through the Eucharist and other symbolic ways, the purpose is the same, to bring the impurities and purify them through a very specific structure of ritual and help us come together as a nation. And so when it comes to morality, when it comes to obligations, we see them actually play an important role played out on the field, even if out in the fandom, on the corners, on the marginal spaces, there's a liminal experience going on where we may paint our faces with our flags and wear our jerseys and sort of become tribalistic. This is absolutely encouraged, something that may be backwards in our secular world. We see that in this specific context, it is encouraged. Another one would be the theodicy aspect or the explanation of evil. What does football have to do with understanding or coping with evil? Well, there's a lot to say there. I think that's one of the main issues when it comes to religion, understanding why bad things happen to good people. And football helps us understand that. Football is not necessarily a just sport. Not the best team always wins. In many cases, goals are not the reflection, the fair reflection of the struggle of the two teams. And yet, when we lose, we do not lose perspective of who we are, our identity, our purpose. Instead, we learn how to cope with our sadness, we learn how to cope for most of the time. We learn how to cope with our humiliation, and we go home. So understanding evil with football is something that is quite universal. And it's not that football is something good, inherently good, or inherently cruel. But it allows us to cope with it and understand it. Perhaps may not be just, but we have reasons and it provides meaning to our world. In fact, Albert Camus once said that everything that he knew about morality and obligation, he learned it from football. And lastly, football is transformational, just like religion. It's not just about belief. There's nothing more touching than, for example, seeing players hugging and crying or also touching and in a very jubilant manner. So all of these very humanizing aspects we can see in football. In fact, you can think about football as a very fair barometer to understand how do we as communities and as individuals, how do we negotiate our capacity for tolerance or our capacity toward violence? How do we treat our opponents, our rivals? How do we treat our players when they fail, our coaches, our fandom? Football really gets to bring out and show us exactly how we tend to cope with this humanizing or dehumanizing tendencies that we have. So that fair play that we find on the field, it is something that we also portray on our everyday life. What kind of inclusion do we have? Do we have diversity portrayed on our teams or not? And that could be a very interesting conversation for another time, women in sports and egalitarianism and so on. And so to close with this transformational aspect of religion and sports, next time when people ask you, is religion true? Perhaps you want to answer, is football true? And that is actually not the point, right? It's about the meaning, the beauty. It's about the identity. It's not about being religious or being a fan of football. It's about the experience itself. So indeed, goals may be facts, and they can show, they provide the cup to the victorious team and so on. But ultimately, we watch football for something else, and that is the immortality of it. Players may change, the coaches come and go all the time, fandom transforms itself as well, but that is what immortality is. It will continue to grow and transform as time goes on. And I'd like to close with a beautiful analogy, Buddhist analogy, the finger pointing to the moon. And it is a warning not to confuse the finger or the means through which you achieve enlightenment or liberation with not confusing the meaning of the game or the meaning of life with goals or the ball itself. There's so much more to it. So sacred space is not just the prerogative of churches or your personal faith. It is absolutely everywhere. It helps us differentiate and navigate the world. So next time you're watching football, perhaps you want to look into those meticulous actions of every player before they come in into the field and how they exit it. Perhaps you want to pay attention to how you watch the sport as well. What kind of rituals do you go through in watching this sport? And also, if you're someone who perhaps consider yourself as religious or spiritual, look into how our world is absolutely awash with religious symbols outside of what we consider our religious quarters. So religion and football are absolutely connected in so many ways, and we can just go on and on and on. But for now, we should just pay attention to how this dynamic affects you as a fan or as a religious person who also enjoys the game. And congratulations to France this year.